ghost that lived in my past bound up in shackles of all my failures. Wondering how long is this gonna last? Then you look at this prisoner and say to me, son, stop fighting it. It's already been won. I am redeemed. And you set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains, wipe away every stain. But when I hear you whisper, child, lift up your head. I remember, oh God, you're not done with me yet. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains. Chains, wipe away every stain. I'm not who I used to be. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains. Wipe away every stain. My righteous. righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. Where you comes my way. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. To teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you.
Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin. perfection now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. It's the name of Jesus. Did it what heaven without us? So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. But what could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What?
Lord, your name is powerful above anything that we can imagine. And because your name is powerful, we can come to you in the name of Jesus, oh Father. And right here and right now, we lift up the people in the community where that shooting took place in a church in Texas. Father, we understand that there was 200 people killed, one of them the preacher's daughter. And Father, we live in a land, we live in a world, we live in a time when evil is very rampant and is very unpredictable. And so, Father, the devil wants us to be afraid, wants us to run in fear, wants us to just shake in our boots and not do anything and to be quiet about the good news of Jesus Christ. And we're not going to do that, God. We're not going to do that. We do lift up these people and their families, the families that are grieving now because of the loss of a loved one, and those who are injured that need healing, touch from you, not just healing in their physical being, but healing from the terror by which it happened. But God, we just plead the blood of Jesus over that community, over that church, over that pastor, over those people. And like David preached this morning, we speak peace.
Yes.
Peace to come to them right now. Peace that passes their understanding. Peace that passes and surpasses the terror of the event. And we just pray, Father, we know your people are there. Your people are in place, people that know you and love you and are ministering. We pray that you will give them wisdom beyond their own, that you will give them insight in their prayers and in their speech to people as they talk with them and they comfort them. We pray for the pastor whose church it is. I can't imagine what you would say to a congregation that's just suffered something like that, especially one of those victims is his daughter. God, bring special strength and comfort to him as he, Father, tries to grapple with, what do I do now? Father, just comfort him, strengthen him. Fill him with your spirit. Refill him with your spirit. Bring peace to his mind, to his heart, and his wife and his family. In the name of, by the power of the sweet presence of Jesus Christ in your sweet spirit. We thank you, Father, for your presence here tonight. And as we praise you and as we worship you and as we prepare our hearts to receive your word, help us to live out that word. When we walk out these doors, that's when the power of the word really takes over, as we live it out day in and day out, moment by moment, every step of our day. Thank you, Father. We give you praise. Move among us tonight. Move among us. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. I'm sure you, maybe not, because it happened just this afternoon sometime or this morning. Is it Austin? Was it Austin? San Antonio. Thank you. San Antonio. And must have been a sizable church. Okay, small town. 20-ish? Okay, wasn't 200? Okay, 20-ish. All right. Okay. I misunderstood. So, oh, you're moving it over. Okay. So, anyway, be in prayer for those people. And one of them was the preacher's daughter, what Bob told me earlier. So, 14-year-old daughter. But a lot of people suffering. Crazy, crazy world we live in. That's why we need Jesus more than ever. Yes. And I don't know if you heard about Jay Blevins or not, but Jay Blevins, one of our friends. In fact, it was David and Gayla and them. Just know him very closely firsthand, and he had a stroke earlier today, and had surgery, and the doctor's word was he was hopeful for his recovery. We don't know what that word hopeful means in this case, you know, but he was going to survive. Don't know to what extent. So we're going to pray for. Let's lift him up right now and pray for that total recovery. Father God, a stroke can be debilitating in many ways, but we lift up Jay Blevins, a dear friend of ours, member of WMF, and David's pastor for many, many years. And we just lift him up before you, and we speak healing into his heart, into his mind. We pray that the effects of that stroke will be neutralized in the name of Jesus, and he will have full function of his whole body, his mind, and his speech and everything. And we just pray, Father, that you will help him to recover without any ill effects. We thank you for the doctor who acted quickly, and we just pray that his actions will result in this total healing as you work within him as well. And we give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, I'm going to call David to come on up right now and to share the word. We've moved this over, so if you guys want to shift, offering. Sorry. Oh, I'm going too many different directions. So ushers, come on down. We're going to do offering now. Surprise. And you just witnessed a miracle. The preacher forgot the offering. How many times that happened, right? I've done it several times, just for the record, okay? But just remember that this entire offering goes to David and his ministry as he continues to minister as he has for so many years. So let's just pray over it. Father God, we thank you and praise you for this offering. We know we're sowing in the good ground, God, and we pray that your Holy Spirit, Father, would just add to this, Lord, and just bless David, and as we give, Father, we know you will give back to us, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. That's your promise, that's your word, and we give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. David, you want to come again? All right. I appreciate David. I've known David for years, and the word he brought today just was as impactful as any word I've ever heard him preach, and I praise God for that, so... Whatever it is, let me push your button.
Well, glory to God. Can you hear me now? All right. You know, there's two things I don't like. I don't like to go to a meeting I can't hear. I'm nearly deaf, so, you know, it's easier for me to find a place like that. But I don't like to go to a meeting where I can't hear. And I don't like to go to a meeting where I can't see the speaker. And I usually sit behind somebody that's tall, and every time I shift, they shift. And, you know, anyway, if you need to shift, you shift. Okay, we got plenty of room to shift where you can see. Anyway, it's good to be here. And you know what I did? I have a great big note here to say thank you to this church for the support y'all have given us over the many years. And you still give it. And I just, you know, everything that we have done in our ministry, you play a direct part in it. Just that simple. You know, so, well, it ain't that much compared to the overall. Yes, it is. It's important, everything that you've done. And not just dollars. I'm talking about prayers, and I'm talking about just encouragement. Just allowing me to come here. I would have paid you to let me come up here. But I waited till after they took an offering for me first. But, you know. No, I just really was looking forward to this. As I told you this morning, this is the first time I've been out almost this whole year. And to be honest about it, I was a little nervous about it. I've never been nervous speaking. It don't bother me at all. But I was nervous about this because I didn't know how I was going to be able to handle it. But I don't know whether y'all think I handled it all right, but I handled it pretty good to me, you know. Amazing. I got by. And so, anyway, I thank this church for what you've done and how you've supported me and Geneva and our ministry. And our ministry is far more than just us. It's you. And every person that's been saved, every person that's been healed, every person that's been ministered to in the last 40-something years, you've played a part in it. Maybe not that long, but for many years here that your church has been going. Anyway, I thank you. Yeah, I've done that. I can forget that note. It's been a good afternoon. It's been a good time. I took a nap this afternoon. It was all about 10 minutes. But Geneva said I usually take a power nap. That's what she used to say. But my power naps is getting to where they're a little long, a little longer. But today, because of my friend, my pastor, probably one of the closest longtime friends that I have, Jay Blevins, and he already told you about him having that stroke. And I'm believing for the healing, just like you prayed. Anyway, I've talked to his son, and there's a lot of hope there, a lot of hope there. All right, well, let's turn to Matthew, the 6th chapter, and I'm going to read verse 24 through 34. And I'm reading out of the New International Version. I usually make notes, and I make whatever notes I'm reading there, I write it down so I kind of remember it most of the time where it came from. That shows you, if you're reading a different version, why you're seeing something a little different maybe than. But it really comes out to the same thing. In the bottom line, it comes out to the same thing. Matthew 6, verse 24. No one can serve two masters. Wow, that's a statement, isn't it? Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds of the air, and they do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet the heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to his life? Why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow? They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you, not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek ye first the kingdom of God, and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of his own. Boy, that's a good statement, you know. You know, we just worry, and about the half the time we come to that next day, we shouldn't even be worried about it to start with, you know. Let me just give you a little bit of history, and I don't think that you don't know a couple of things I'm about to say. Number one is in Genesis 1, 26 and 27, God creates man, you know. He creates man in his likeness and his image, and he gives man dominion and authority over the whole world. That's what the Bible says. I didn't say that. He did. Absolute, total authority. And then he told him, go out and replenish, multiply. I got 14 grandchildren and 14 great-grandchildren and 4 great-great-grandchildren, so I'm doing my best, Lord, you know. You know, God provides everything that they needed in the Garden of Eden. They put them in the Garden of Eden, and he provided every single thing they needed. And then he pointed this tree out and said, don't eat that tree. Because if you eat from that tree, you're going to die. What that really means is you're going to be separated from God. It's death of the body, but it's also death of the spirit, separation from God. Just The Bible's telling us here, God provided the needs. Now just leave that alone. God knew what they needed. God cared what they needed. And God provided what they needed. And he's still doing it. Because the Bible says this in Hebrews 13, verse number 8, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. In John 1, 1, it tells us that God, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the 14th verse says, and he became flesh, or Jesus. Jesus is the Word here. Jesus is God. And he cares. He cares. All we need to do is seek him. Strive after him is what we're talking about. Make it your will. Make it your will to know him and serve him. It's one thing for me to make it my will, but it's not, I can't make it your will. You got to do that. Even Jesus asked the disciples, who do they say that I am? Well, they say you're one of the prophets and et cetera. But then Jesus looked at Peter and said, who you say I am. That's what he's interested in, and he's wanting us to just seek him, love him, and obey him. Just do what he says, like we said this morning in the message there. Matthew 6 is our text there, and in verse number 26 it says, look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Talking about the birds. The birds. Geneva used to love to watch the birds, and I have a lot of folks in here that like to look at birds. And she even bought bird books, and she's written down in some of those books where we saw some birds, you know, and some kind, and I never did really get involved in that, but we look in some of those books now, and she had circled and named the date and where we were when this particular bird she saw. Well, you know, God cared about that bird. And the Heavenly Father, he fed them, you know. He knew what they needed. And don't you think that we're more important than that bird? That's what the Bible said. Don't you think that you're more valuable to God than that bird? Jesus fed the people. Well, we've got that. You know, Jesus had all these folks following him. The Bible tells us, you know, he had all following him. And the Bible tells us that Jesus says, these people are hungry. They've been walking here and following us. And what does he say? He said, they're even about to faint. Don't he say that basically? We need to feed them. And all they had was a little boy had a couple of fish and, you know, just a little bit, a handful of stuff, and said, feed them. And they had more left than they started with after feeding 5,000 men, not counting the women and children there. He cared that much about them with two little old fish and five loaves of bread, and their loaves of bread are not that big, even if it's a big loaf. He's got a lot of people out there, you know. We had a school in India that y'all helped support. We had to close that school last April the 1st. And the reason was because of the law in India, not the lack of support. But I remember when I was in India the first time, and I was in the home of Julius and Ruth Marar. And they had just a few children that they were trying to educate. Both Julius and Ruth had master's degrees in education. They were called of God to preach too, but they had master's degrees in education. So they was interested in educating children the ABCs of life. And who they were wanting to deal it with was the untouchables, the poorest people in India. In a state that's the poorest state in India, the most populated state in India, the state of UP state where our school was had 250 million people in that one state. Just that one state. And it was 97, I believe, percent, don't hold me to that, but it's pretty close, illiterate. 95 to 99% Hindu. The Hindu nation was formed in this particular city that our school was in, Gorakhpur, India. The most hardline Hindu people in the whole system is in Gorakhpur. And this is where we were going to start school. The population of Christians was 0.005%. Well, we had to close the school in April because the law said that we couldn't operate anymore. And it's a long story, so we won't get into that. But anyway, we did close it, and I asked Julius to give me a figure over how many people we actually educated and taught about Jesus. And in the 25 years that that school operated, we educated 12,641, I believe is the figure. 12,641 children got an education because of you guys. Think of that. And out of that 12,600, over 60%, maybe as high as 70%, became Christians. In an area where they had 0.005% Christians when we started. A church was birthed. Now, what am I talking about? I'm talking about God cared about those children. And when I was sitting in that living room and they were telling me what they wanted to do, start a school, and they wanted to feed them one day, one time a week. And I asked them, well, what are you going to do? Where are you going to get the money to do what you're talking about? You know what their answer was? We don't know. That was their question. Well, that's not a big deal. They wasn't expecting but 25 children. What, 25? That wasn't a big deal. Feed them one time. On the airplane coming home, the Lord spoke to me. You know, it's bad when the Lord gets messing with you. And the Lord says, David, about that school, I want you to sponsor that school, your ministry, to sponsor that school. And I interrupted the Lord, and I just said, Lord, did you know there's two words that I'm thinking about? One of them is sponsored, and the other is support. And they're different. And God said, I know the language. I said, well, sponsor means that I am responsible for it. Support means I'm just sending some money. You hear what I'm saying?
Yes.
He said, your ministry is going to be sponsoring that school. Well, I asked the Lord the same question that I asked Julius. Now, where's the money coming from? Because we didn't have that kind of money, even though it was just 25 children. But the Lord also said, I want you to feed them every day, not just once a week. Every day. I went home and told Geneva, the board, the one, Dwayne Nimitz on our board, and said, this is what the Lord told me, what we're going to do. And they said, let's do what God said. Let's support it. I want to tell you something. We had as high as 850 children in the school three different years. We never got less than 300. The very first day, we had 26, not 25. Not one single time. Now, listen very carefully to what I'm talking about. I'm talking about God knows our circumstance. God cares about our circumstance. And God provides.
Amen.
We built five or four buildings, school buildings, built out of steel and concrete. They weren't built out of wood. It'll fall real soon or wear out. Steel and concrete. And they even had, there was a two-story building, and even had the ability to go two more stories high. We had put that kind of foundation in it. They were built to stay there. We fed those children. We clothed those children. We gave them medical attention. Geneva saw that they didn't have any shoes on. How about going and buying 500 pair of shoes and then just keep on doing that? Now what I'm trying to say, not one single time did we have a need that we already didn't have the money in the bank.
Thank you, Lord.
We had the money in the bank every single time we started to do something. We didn't put out anything and say, we need to raise this fund. They just come in. We never put out anything in our ministry that we're about to go out of the country and you send us some money and help us go out. And I don't have any problem with that. Don't misunderstand what I'm saying. I don't have any problem with that. But we didn't do it. It was there. This money that's coming in just like this was going into a fund that would take care of that kind of stuff. Why? Because God cares and He has called us to do that. God cares about you and He cares about that meal you need.
That's right.
He cares about that dollar you need.
That's right.
He cares about that healing you need. And I've told this particular story 100 times in this particular area probably. Geneva and I and my sister and her husband was in Pascagoula, Mississippi one time at noon. Was having a meeting that night in a full gospel businessmen's meeting. And then the next day in an Assembly of God church. And it was on a Saturday at noon, and we stopped in this Pizza Hut to have lunch. And I'm sitting there, and I really wasn't that hungry, but I was sitting there eating just like they were. And all of a sudden, the Spirit of the Lord drew my attention to a young couple over in the corner. You know, Pizza Hut has corners too. And there's a little bitty booth over there, and they were in that little booth. And God drew my attention to them, and then God said, get up and go give them some money. Now, how many of you do what God says just as soon as He says it? I said, no, I don't know those people. You know, get that out of my mind. And it just kept on going. I couldn't even join my eating because of just going through my mind. Finally, I got up and went to the men's room just thinking by moving around, I'll get this out of my mind, you know. I don't want to do that, God. And while I'm in the men's room, I take a $5 bill out of my billfold and stick it in my shirt pocket. I guess I've always thought, if I give in to God, at least it'll be handy, you know. I don't know. I never have figured that out. I put that $5 bill up there in my pocket and I went back out and tried to eat. Finally, I got up and I just couldn't eat. And I just went over to that table. And when I walked up to it, that young couple looked up at me. They was about 20 years old. They looked up at me like, what do you want? And I said, folks, it don't matter who I am. You don't know me. But I want to do what God told me to do so I can go back and enjoy my lunch. And I pulled that $5 bill out and just threw it on the table. Didn't hand it to them, just threw it on the table. They looked down at that $5 bill. They looked back up at each other. They looked back at that $5 bill and then looked up at me. And I said, what's going on? They said, we come in here, we ordered, we ate, and we found out we didn't have any money. And our bill was $5. What am I talking about? God knows your need.
Yes, He does. Yes, He does.
And God cares about your need.
That's right.
And God will provide for it.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Those two young people, I asked them, do you know Jesus? They said, no. They never have asked Him in their life. And I said, I want to ask you something. I'm not going to preach to you, but I'm just going to say this. If you think just out of the blue, I just decided I wanted to come over here and give you $5, then you take that $5, you go pay your bill, and you forget about it. But if you can think for just a moment, that God loved you so much that He spoke to a total stranger to pay your bill.
Yeah.
And right then and there in the Pizza Hut, the place crowded, two young people accepted Christ.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
Yeah, give the Lord a hand. Thank you, Lord. You know, God, He cares about us. Verse 33 says, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness and all these things. will be given to you as well. How many? All. Bruce Blevins, Jay's son, he was preaching one day in our church, and he said, I did a study on the word all. And he says, you know what it means? It means all. I said, well, you know, that's pretty smart. It didn't take a whole lot of study to get that one, but seek him results in provision. Everything you need. God provides not only food, he not only provides money, he provides shelter. You know, he provides a home, he provides some place for you to sleep. What we have a young lady in Sunday school this morning, and I don't know who she was. She's not here now, so I can tell this. She said she was actually walking, but she may have said it in church. I don't remember. I heard it this morning. I know who said it. Anyway, she said she actually heard her husband was homeless, living on the street. Didn't know where the next dollar was coming from. Never where they're going. And step by step, she walked through how God provided this and provided that. And then she said, and suddenly I realized I've got a roof over my head. Wow, what a statement. And she was giving God the entire credit for it right then and right there. God provides healing. Mark 5, he's the woman with the issue of blood. She reached out and touched the hem of his garment because of her faith. She was healed. Jesus said that. God provided the healing when she, by faith, reached into it. I mentioned this morning the leper in Mark 1, verse 40 and 41. If I didn't mention it, it was in my notes. I was supposed to. But anyway, this leper came up to Jesus, blocking his way, and said, I know you can heal me, but will you? You know, there's a whole lot of people where that leper's at. Yeah. They're sitting in our churches today that's walking in the fullness of power of God, baptized in the Holy Ghost and saved, and saying, Jesus, I know you can, but will you? Yeah. What did Jesus do? He said, I will. Yeah. And he touched him, and instantly he became clean. Yeah. Just like that. Well, that's a simple thing, wasn't it? Mark 10, blind Bartimaeus. He wanted to be healed, and he heard Jesus was coming down the road, and he went to hollering, Jesus, 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 and whatever he was hollering, you know, trying to get his attention. And all of the people that was with Jesus, those super spiritual people, said, be quiet. Be quiet. Don't bother him. And tell what he's doing? His disciples. But Jesus heard him. You call out to him and he's going to hear you. Come on. Come on. And he heard him and he said, I'm not moving till you bring that man to me. And that blind man came up to him and he said, what do you want? He said, I want to see. And God opened his eyes. He saw. In Romania, the last trip I was over there, and she was there, but the last night that we was in Romania, that particular trip, the team had been going for 2 weeks real hard, and this church was not on the schedule, and we had to be at the airport at 3:00 the next morning. So I told the whole team, you just stay at the motel, Duane and her husband Buster and me, we'll go over to this church. And there was, I'm talking about a ton of people, about the size of the center part here of the church. And there wasn't a spare room anywhere in it. They was in the aisles, and they were right up to the pulpit. The praise team behind me, they had to stay behind me. They didn't have much room to start with. And one of those people in that praise team was blind. I mean, he was blind, not just almost blind. Not just legally blind. He was blind. He could see absolutely nothing. This particular praise team had been at our meetings over the years when we was holding ministers' conferences, and I knew him. We knew the whole team. And I prayed for nearly everybody in the sanctuary that night. And we was getting real close to the church, and the Spirit of the Lord told me to pray for the blind man. And I turned around, and I prayed a simple prayer, Lord, open his eyes. And I probably prayed for him before, but this time God told me to do it. And I turned around and laid my hands on him and prayed for him for his eyes to be open. And I turned around and faced the congregation, took about one step from him, and the Lord turned me back around. And I looked at him and I said, sir, he can't see me, but I said, sir, when I come back to India, you're going to be able to see me. Now, about the time I got through saying that, I thought, man, that's the dumbest thing that you could say. Or it was God. That was my thought. Man, that's stupid to say something like that unless it is God. Yeah. 30 days later, we got a picture of that man and one of the pastors that we work with in Romania. That man's eyes was 20/20, and he drives a cab in Bucharest, Romania now.
Thank you, Lord.
Wow! What am I saying? I think God cares about your circumstance. I don't know what your circumstance is. I don't know what it is. But he does. He does. When Adam hid, he'd ate the wrong fruit, and he hid, the next thing he did, he hid from God after that, and God said, where are you? Don't you think God knew where he was? What's God really wanting? He says, Adam, do you really know where you are in relationship with me?
That's right. Absolutely.
Do you recognize where you are right now in relationship to me? God knew he was hiding there. I'm going to speed it up. No, I'm not. Sand Springs, Oklahoma. The Methodist Church. Revival. On the third day of the revival, there was a visitor came, and this woman came forward for prayer. And at the time, I was still asking what people need. I could hear them. You know, you might tell me and I not hear you here. A woman told me one time to pray for her, and I said, what do you need? You know, she's in the prayer line. The next thing I'm doing, I'm praying. I said, Lord, she needs a child. She wants to have it. She's, no, that's not what I said. Yeah, she stopped that prayer in a hurry. Well, this woman told me what she wanted. She said, I've got something inside me. My stomach's hurt. My whole inside's hurt, and it cramps all the time. And I really believe, and the doctors believe, I've got some cancer in there. And, you know, it was just a real bad thing, and it was all pain in there. Well, we prayed a simple prayer, Lord, you heal her. Just a simple prayer, claiming the word of God, just a short thing.
Sure.
Nothing happened. And she left by herself. She's back the next night. When she came back the next night, she said, on the way home last night from church, I got to hurting so bad, my stomach was rolling so bad that I had to stop the car. And I felt like I was going to heave. So I got out of the car. I didn't want to mess up the inside of the car. She said, I began to heave, and I heaved, she said, over a gallon of stuff. She described that stuff, and I don't want to do that. That stuff. And she was throwing it up there, and actually her pain went out as that stuff went.
Thank you, Jesus.
Later I heard that was gone. She was healed. That may have been cancer. I don't know what it was. And she didn't care what it was. It was gone. And that was what counted.
That's right.
You know, God provides whatever you need. That's what I'm trying to say. Mm-hmm. He provides. Philippians 4, verse number 19 says, but my God shall supply part of your needs all your needs, according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. He's got it all, so he can supply. He supplies some strange things sometimes. I don't speak English too well, much less some other language, you know. And I was out of Paris, about 20 miles out of downtown Paris, and me and Geneva. And we got to this little church, and they had to provide an interpreter, because I couldn't talk to them otherwise. And the interpreter that normally does the interpretery for them, because it's not unusual for someone to come through and speak, and they need an interpreter. Anyway, the interpreter wasn't there. So they found a young man there, they knew a young man there in the church that spoke both English and spoke French. So they talked to him into coming and interpreting for me. Well, I speak Arkansas, I don't speak English. You know, and I... half the time he didn't know what I was saying. The other half he couldn't hear what I was saying. Because when I go to preaching like that sometimes, I get excited about it, and I turn my head this way, and he's standing over here, and he couldn't even hear what I was saying. Besides that, I'm walking all over what he's saying. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
If you've never been where interpreters are taken, you don't know what I'm talking about. But when you've been around them, you know, and I'm bad about that. We went through that whole service with him trying, and he was just coming apart. And I knew we wasn't getting very far, but when I gave the invitation, we had a powerful move of God. People getting saved and people getting healed and all kinds of miracles taking place. There was 5 visitors there from England. They spoke fluent English, naturally, and fluent French. They told the pastor that they have been in hundreds of meetings where there was interpretations, and that was the most accurate interpretation they had ever heard. Who was doing it? It was God. It wasn't that guy, because he couldn't hear me. You know. Talking about France, I was in D, France, spelled D-I-E, die, but they call it D. And Geneva wasn't with me the first trip I was there, and in D, France, and I was staying in a house that there was a lawyer and his wife and 3 children, small children. And of course, he had to go to the office, and the children and mama stayed at home, and I'm staying there. And I don't speak French, and she don't speak English. But I was sitting in a den area or whatever you want to call it, a living room or where it was that they sit. And we're just sitting there looking at each other grinning, you know. That's about, I get sick of grinning sometimes like that, you know. And just sitting there grinning, I saw this book that's about 3 times as big as this, and it was an English-French dictionary. The first half of it was all in France, French. And the back half of it was English. The French word over here was defined in English over here. And the English word was defined for somebody else in French. You know what we did? We picked that book up, and me and her had a conversation that lasted 3 hours, talking one word at a time. And in that 3 hours, I led that woman to the Lord and the baptism of the Holy Ghost.
Really?
Thank you, Lord.
Who did that? Not me. Had to be God. What am I talking about? Now, once again, God knows our circumstance. God cares about us. Whatever it is, he cares. And God will provide that need. I'm going to close with this. God knows your situation. And he cares about it. And he wants to meet you right where your situation is. My baby sister was 73 years old in May. She passed away. She was a bad diabetic. She went blind because of diabetes. She had a bad medical situation for the last 10 years of her life, but she kept on going. She ended up living where my mama lived, and she and my mom lived, and she stayed there when mom passed away. And her daughter moved in there, and she's staying there too, and about 50 years old. She had a cat. And this cat would honor as far as I was concerned. But she loved that cat. Mama loved that cat. But one night, Donna was in her bedroom. That's my sister's daughter. About 2 o'clock in the morning, she was in bed asleep. And that cat came in there and jumped on her bed. I mean, jumped up on Donna's bed and was making all kinds of noise and jumping up and down on the bed. And Donna woke up, and just as soon as she woke up, the cat jumped off the bed. Jumped off the bed, and Donna was trying to lay back just a little bit, and the cat wouldn't let her. The cat just still making a noise, and so she got up to kick the cat out of the house or something, you know, but it was disturbing her. And she got up, and the cat ran from her. And she took off after it, and the cat ran into my sister's bedroom and jumped up on my sister's bed. And my sister was in a diabetic coma and would have been dead in just a matter of hours. And that cat brought Donna in there. And she got on the phone immediately, and the fire department and ambulance was there, and they brought her out of that coma.
Wow.
Don't tell me God don't meet your need.
Wow.
And he'll use whatever he has to use to meet your needs. Father, in Jesus' name. Oh, God, I just love you tonight. I thank you, Father, for the fact that I know right now that you care about our circumstance. You care what we are. You care what we're going through. You care what we need. And you'll provide it. And you've proved that to me over and over and over as I've experienced you, Lord. Lord, I just thank you right now that you're moving among us people right now, out here in this church.
Yes.
And do you know the circumstance of every person here as an individual? You want to touch that need right now in Jesus' name. You know, as I look across the audience, I see a house full of Christians. I see a house full of believers. But Jesus looked down the road. And down the road, Jesus was hungry, and he looked down the road and he saw a fig tree. And that fig tree looked like it was bearing figs. But Jesus walked up to that tree and he parted the leaves and he saw there was no figs there. And Jesus cursed that fig tree and said, no man will eat from you again. And that fig tree died from the roots up. I don't know you. I see you. But Jesus sees beyond the leaves.
That's right.
You and you alone know where you stand with Jesus. I think you stand okay. But you know. And God knows. First of all, if you've never asked Jesus in your heart, that's what he's wanting you to do. That's the most important thing. That's the most important need you have if you've never done that. So if you hadn't, I'm going to ask you quickly just to hold your hand up and you wave at me. And I'll know what you mean. You just mean, David, pray for me that I might know Jesus. Is there one here right now? I wouldn't be an evangelist if I didn't ask you that. That's the most important message I have. Father, I thank you that I've got a house full of believers here. Now, Lord, I thank you that you care about their circumstance, and I ask you right now to begin to move in their life, Lord. And if there's one person, any person that has a need here tonight, that they come to you, I believe you, Lord, that you're going to meet that need tonight. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Stand with me, please, in Jesus' name. And I'm going to invite you right now to come up here. It's not going to take but a few minutes. You come up here, and your step of faith, just like that leper stepping out in the front of Jesus and saying to Jesus, I know you can, but will you? And your step of faith is stepping out here. You're stepping out to Jesus saying, I know you can, but will you? And Jesus' answer is, I will. So I'm going to ask you to come right now. Just line up here. If there's that many here that has a need, you come right now. Don't wait till next week, because I'm not going to be here next week. Jesus will be, but I'm not going to be. God wants to save you right now. He wants to touch you and heal you right now. Meet that need right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for every person that's taking that step of faith. Take a step or two right up towards me. I'm not telling you to fall down, but if you do, I don't want you to hit those chairs. Thank you, Lord. Falling down is not what gets you healed anyway. What gets you healed is the touch of God. Thank you, Lord. I don't believe that everybody falls. It's going down in the spirit. Some of them want to go down. Some of them think they're supposed to go down. And some of them go down because the Spirit of the Lord puts them down. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you for each person up here right now. Lord, I don't know what their needs are. You do. But I'm putting my faith on the line with you today in them. Lord, believing that you're about to touch them, heal them. You're about to restore health, Lord. Lord, if it's finances, we ask the purse strings of heaven to be opened up and pour out an abundance on them, Lord. I don't know where it's coming from, but I believe you're going to meet their needs, Lord. Lord, if it's whatever, touch that need today. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you for this brother. I thank you for what's happened to him tonight.
Drink from the cup in your hand. Lay back again. to sit at your feet.
Ain't God good? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I tell you what, I've had fun today. I had fun tonight, and I appreciate y'all just putting up with me. I love you, and I love you more than you'll ever know, but God loves you a lot more than I do. And I thank the Lord for blessing y'all in every way he can. Now, I asked you to sing "Oh, How I Love Jesus" this morning, and I may have messed your whole program up by doing that. Anyway, I've sang that all over the world where people knew that song. And I don't want to miss out on it tonight either. And so I want you to sing it right now before he takes over, because I don't know what he's going to do. He may preach. Let's sing it out right now. Come on.
Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me.
All right, we're gonna do something here. I'm gonna call David and Gayla over here, just to kind of join us over here. And we have somewhat of a tradition here when we have a revival, with special speakers in, evangelists, missionaries. We don't do this all the time, but most of the time we do. We like to gather around and pray a prayer of blessing upon them. Okay, so if you'd all, whoever wants to, come on up. We'll just gather around them. Just kind of step forward a little bit. We'll just, you get in the donut hole, okay? Now, we've done this before, but Geneva was with us at the time, okay? She's no longer with us in body, but we know she's with us in spirit. And but David continues his ministry, and David quoted her today that says, David, God has given you a ministry to the world. You keep ministering. So that's what he's doing. He's being obedient to God and to the call that God has on his life, even though he's 86 years old. He's continuing to plug away and just bring God's word and God's healing power to those in need. So let's just pray that blessing. Father God, we come in the name of Jesus. We thank you for David and Gayla. And we thank you, God, for their faithfulness to you. Thank you for David and Geneva, and for the many, 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 many years that they traveled and ministered, and for the many, many thousands upon thousands of people, literally, that have been touched and changed. Their lives have been changed because of your working through your faithful servants. We know it's all glory to you, God, but you got to have willing vessels, and they are willing, and they have been willing and are continue to be willing to be used by you. And so, Father, I pray that you will continue to just lead and guide David in his ministry, and Gayla as she's by his side, Father, doing what she can. But God, we also pray for your continued comfort to be upon them. Father, we know that grieving process takes a long, long time, especially when you've been married for 68 years to a spouse. Father, we just pray that your Holy Spirit's strength and joy and comfort would just rest upon David and Gayla, Father, and the rest of the family, Father, who are not here, but they need it as well. And just know that they are never alone. And Father, someday we're going to be united with her, and we're going to look back on this earthly life we lived, and it was just a breath. And Father, just bless them, lead them and guide them, and we give you praise and glory. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. All right. Now give somebody a hug.